When I went into Iraq, we believed that the Iranians had two diametrically opposed goals. One, they wanted a friendly Iraqi government installed. And two, they wanted the U.S. government to fail in its efforts to establish a democratic government inside of Iraq that respected the human rights of all Iraqis. It became clear to us over time that there was an active campaign that leveraged financial support to political organizations, humanitarian support across the south of Iraq, and military support to Shia militia to accomplish these objectives. I got my first indications of Iranian influence in Iraq about 60 days after I arrived. Some of you will recall that in the summer of 2004, coalition and Iraqi forces mounted a significant operation to break the stranglehold of the Sadrist militia on the important Iraqi town of Najaf. We succeeded. And in our review of our actions, we found something that we almost lost in the heat of battle. We found an intercept from a Quds Force operative transmitting directly from the Imam Ali shrine to Tehran, reporting it on the battle. Now, while that was my first indication, it was just the beginning of what became a harbinger of things to come. Our knowledge of what the Iranians were up to grew over time, over the next 18 months, as the Iraqis elected a parliament, developed and ratified a constitution, and elected a government based on that constitution. And throughout that period, we continued to follow their actions to train and equip the security forces and to influence the political process in Iraq to include the selection of two Iraqi prime ministers. I will tell you that I didn't grasp the full extent of Iranian activity until after the bombing of the Al-Askari Mosque in February of 2006. Around that time, we began to see some troubling trends. First was that we found a new and very lethal improvised explosive device. And I will tell you, without getting technical, it was clear to us that parts of the IED had to be manufactured precisely, and tools for that didn't exist in Iraq. It could only come from Iran. We had to work our way through the intelligence business. It's one thing to know that Iran is providing materiel and training. It's quite another to find the people that are conducting that provision of materiel and training in a city of 8 million people in a country of 27 million people. To do that, we set up an intelligence cell that focused on nothing but determining the impact of malign and Iranian influence in Iraq. We also made sure that the new government of Iraq clearly understood what Iran was up to.
So as we, in our early days in Iraq, I will tell you that the political influence was very visible, but what was not visible to us in the early days was the military influence. In fact, we got our first inkling of Iraqi Quds Force influence in Iraq, Iranian Quds Force influence in Iraq, about 35 days after I got there. And some of you will remember in early August of 2004, there was a major battle in Najaf. As we went forward, basically throughout 2005, we were executing the process that had been given to us by the United Nations Security Council. We were to have elections in January 2005 to elect a transitional government, a transitional parliament, that would draft a constitution. We would hold a referendum on that constitution in October, and then the Iraqis would conduct a further election in December of 2005 that would elect a government based on that constitution. So you then had in Iraq a constitutionally elected Iraqi government that would guide the country forward. We saw increased Iranian influence in the election process. Lots of money to Iraqi political parties, lots of humanitarian support in the name of gaining political support. But it wasn't until the summer of 2005 where we began to see increased military support. And at that point, we saw increased Iranian arming of the Shia militia with some improvised explosive devices that were just talked about here earlier. And what we saw was our casualties were going up. So we launched a significant effort to find out where the Iranian operatives were in Iran. Because it's one thing to be able to say, yes, there's political influence, yes, there's economic influence, but to tell me where the Quds Force operative is at what time, in what place, on what floor in the apartment building so that they can be attacked is quite another thing. So we began a significant intelligence gathering process that would allow us to target the Iranian groups. Let me talk just a second about these improvised explosive devices. They're called explosively formed penetrators. I don't want to get too technical, but they have to be made with machine tools. And that technology was not available in Iraq. They could only come from one place, and that was Iran. And these are designed, the explosives are formed in a way that they shoot a copper charge that goes so fast that it'll actually penetrate the side of a tank. And this was a significant problem for our soldiers and the Iraqi soldiers because their armored vehicles were their best protection against the improvised explosive devices. About 2 months after we started seeing the increase of this, we actually found a cache in Sadr City. And the cache was full of these, and they were clearly made in Iran. In addition, we found the newest type of rocket-propelled grenade that was also made in Iran. And we found a number of mortar rounds and rockets that were clearly marked with Iranian markings. And we continued over the fall and winter of 2005 to find this type of equipment. Hadi Al-Amri was also the head of the Badr Corps, which was a Shia militia tied to this Skiri party now called ISKI. We believe that the Badr Corps was an active militia and was actively out conducting attacks against primarily Sunni civilians. After the elections in 2005, I asked for a meeting with them because I wanted to see if there was any reason that we should try to work with the Badr Corps. And in the course of this meeting, he was sitting directly across the table from me, and I popped the question to him. I looked him right in the eye and said, "Mr. Amri, are you being supported by Iran?" And he stopped. He paused, and he went like this. "No." And that told me that he was lying, and it told me that I had nothing left to do with Hadi Al-Amri. And the fact that he got into the White House is unbelievable to me. The other element in 2006 that I wanted to mention is we briefed the new incoming Prime Minister, Prime Minister Maliki, who you've heard about today. But we showed him what was being done by the Iranians in Iraq. And when I finished the briefing, he looked at me and said, "They are conducting terrorism in my country." And I said, "You're right, Prime Minister, they are, and it needs to stop." We also briefed the Presidency Council and showed them the same thing, and they had a similar reaction. But the answer was there was not the political will by the Iraqis to pressure the Iranians to stop the disruption. All of our hard work on intelligence came to bear fruition in right before Christmas of 2006. And we had been tracking some operatives around Baghdad, and we caught six of them in what amounted to a safe house. And there were, we thought they were all Quds Force operatives, but the Iranian embassy immediately said that four of the operatives were actually under diplomatic protection because they worked for the embassy. The other two they couldn't make that argument for, so we hung on to them. But what did we find? First, we found the location we found them was right adjacent to the Badr Corps headquarters. And then they had maps on the wall that clearly showed that they were plotting to push the Sunni population out of the neighborhoods they were in so they could expand the control of the Shia militias across Baghdad. I mean, they had sections of Baghdad marked in different colors and arrows on the maps designating the way for future operations. There was money, there was weapons receipts, there was no question that this was an Iranian-supported operation. As with any good operation, we exploited the information there and were able to continue to put pressure on the Iranian operatives throughout 2007 and gradually reduce the flow of support. Why do I tell you all this? It's some of its ancient history. But I tell you all this because that is how Iran operates. They destabilized Iraq. They used terror as the means of accomplishing their political and ideological objectives. They're a destabilizing force in Iraq. They're a destabilizing force in the region. And it is not a regime that is capable of being a productive member of this world order. And they will not be removed without an effective and active democratic opposition. Thank you very much.